announcements. As I suspect you, most of you know, Pastor Danny's still away on vacation. This is his last Sunday. He'll be away from us for a while.
Two sons. A few days later, this younger son packed all his belongings and moved to a distant land. And there he wasted all his money in wild living. Woohoo! About the time his money ran out, a great famine swept over the land, and he began to starve. He persuaded a local farmer to hire him, and the man sent him into his fields to feed the pigs. Now, imagine, this is a Jewish man working for a farmer, and he's told to tend the pigs. And pigs are not considered clean animals in the Jewish faith. But that's who he had to take care of. Ultimate humiliation. The young man became so hungry that even the pods he was feeding the pigs looked good to him, but no one gave him anything. Does this look like a nice meal? This is what the prodigal son was eating. It's basically, if you've ever grown peas in your backyard and you open up the pod and you squeeze out all the peas and those go into the salad or whatever you're going to eat them, and what's left is this, and that's what he was left to eat. When he finally came to his senses, he said to himself, "At home, even the hired servants have food enough to spare. And here I am dying of hunger. I will go home to my father and say, 'Father, I have sinned against both heaven and you, and I am no longer worthy of being called your son. Please take me on as a hired servant.' And so he returned home to his father. And while he was still a long way off, his father saw him coming. Filled with love and compassion, he ran to his son, embraced him, and kissed him. And his son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against both heaven and you, and I'm no longer worthy of being called your son.' But his father said to the servants, 'Quick, bring the finest robe in the house and put it on him. Get a ring for his finger and sandals for his feet, and kill the calf we have been fattening. We must celebrate with a feast. For this son of mine was dead and has now returned to life. He was lost, and now he is found.' So the party began." Look at this picture. Look at this face. In the prophet Isaiah, it is said that he had no form or comeliness that we should want to look on him. Often when you see pictures on the internet of Jesus, it's a blue-eyed blonde from the south of France, very beautiful, sometimes quite effeminate. This face is probably a much more accurate reflection of what Jesus looked like. His skin may well have been even darker than that. His hair was curly, and he never cut it. He just sort of chopped it off when it got in the way, kind of like mine, except mine has never grown long enough in 9 years to get in the way, so I still haven't cut it. Don't plan to. But I want you to think of this face. We'll come back to it. Play the video, please.
If you're a woman over 40 and have struggled to lose weight, stop what you're doing and listen up. You can flatten your belly without bogus fat burner pills.
fearless warrior, commanding King of Kings, mighty conqueror, and the only time, I ever saw him run was when he ran to me. He took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, said my son was coming home again, lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes with forgiveness in his voice. He said, son, do you know I still love you? He caught me by surprise when God ran. I left home, I knew I'd broken his heart. Wonder then if things could ever be the same. Then one night I remembered his love for me, and down a dusty road ahead I could see it was the only time, was the only time I ever saw him run. Held my head to his chest, said my son's coming home again, lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes with forgiveness in his voice. He said, son, do you know I still love you? He caught me by surprise, and he brought me to my knees when God.
Accounts, there are several stories about Jesus healing blind people, people with no sight. In one particular case, which I relate to most strongly, this comes out of the Gospel of Mark. When they arrived at Bethsaida, some call it Bethesda, some people brought a blind man to Jesus and they begged him to touch the man and heal him. Jesus took the blind man by the hand and led him out of the village, and then spitting on the man's eyes, he laid his hands on him and asked, "Can you see anything now?" The man looked around and said, "Yes, I see people, but I can't see them very clearly. They look like trees walking around." Then Jesus placed his hands on the man's eyes again, and his eyes were opened. His sight was completely restored, and he could see everything clearly. Next slide. With forgiveness in his voice, he said, "Son." He called me son. He said, "Son, do you know I still love you?" Some of you know my testimony and may recall how I met Jesus after a Grateful Dead concert. Nice little image, next image. Our Lord told me when he visited me that night, and he said, "Tell my people I love them." Did I take this touch and immediately repent of my sins? Do I hear a pin drop? I did not. Did I put down the pig pods I was eating? No. No. I got out of line, sorry. I'm up to 21 now. We're all familiar with foreign missionaries. We've had a lot of people come in here and talk about their work in the Orient, in Asia, in Africa. In addition to foreign missions, or what we refer to as the Assembly of God World Missions, there is another department that is called the Assembly of God U.S. Missions. And I am part of Assembly of God U.S. Missions as a chaplain. Now, the Department of World Missions, I'm sorry, the Department of U.S. Missions has this little catchphrase, partnering with the church to reach America. And defines, or at least presents, the idea that chaplains are those who share the gospel outside of the four walls of the church. Some of the places you can find a chaplain include the military, police and fire departments, prisons, motorcycles, in a semi-truck at the rodeo, and more. Malcolm Burley is the director of AG U.S. Missions. And in an article recently in one of the AG publications, it says chaplains are widely known for their work in hospitals, prisons, and the military. However, they also serve in 37 other specialized areas. As of the beginning of this year, there were 773 endorsed chaplains, including yours truly. My endorsement is specifically for healthcare and corporate chaplaincy. My initial endorsement was for corrections, and I've received a little bit of correction about my corrections ministry, so I'm sort of under, probation. Looking forward to getting that added back into my endorsement. And I want to share you a little bit about what it's like to be Chaplain Steve. I was introduced to my first prison mentee in 2005 while he was on house arrest. I was with him for his trial, his sentencing, and eventually his incarceration in the state prison. 16 years so far. He's 5 months younger than me. He turned 64 last Tuesday. He will reach his minimum sentence in 2024, 3 years away. Actually, 3 years, it was the 3 years as of April, so it's a little bit less than 3 years now. As a model prisoner, he will be eligible for parole, and he will be 67 when this happens. I'll be there when he's released. I've done that for 6 other men who have returned to society after their time in prison. I've done that for 2 other men when they were released from jail. Currently, there are 8 men inside who have my contact information and touch base with me regularly. Let me tell you 3 stories about 3 of those men that I've seen outside. First one is Jeff. The day I picked up Jeff started very early. My alarm went off at 4 o'clock in the morning, or actually it would have gone off at 4 o'clock, but I was so excited. And too excited to sleep, so I woke up about 2:30. Lovely time to wake up. Lay in bed praying. I knew I had a long drive ahead and I needed to get to the prison by 8 o'clock just in case they released him early. And as I said, Jeff is not his real name, but that's what I'll call him. He had been in prison for 4 years. And while he had served his maximum sentence, he still faced 2 years probation. I had loaded my car the day before with the belongings that he had left behind at his apartment when he was arrested. His former landlord had sold the house, and I was dispatched to collect his belongings when they closed the sale. I took everything in my car with me to pick up Jeff, except his bicycle. When he walked out of prison, he had several cartons of clothes and other belongings. I was the first person on the outside that Jeff saw. I'm sorry, but I can't run. But every other part about when God ran, I try to personify for these guys. Jeff was fortunate. Most returning souls have nothing but what was in their pockets when arrested. We went to a family diner and ate lunch. He had been too excited to eat at prison, nor the first 2 hours of our drive. He didn't finish his lunch. He had gotten used to poor prison food, and he never cared to eat all of what he was served. He had lost weight inside, and he was okay with that. We found his new apartment. The prison's notice to his new landlord had the date wrong, so his unit was not ready. They put him in a smaller unit that required stairs. He was happy that it didn't involve a flimsy mattress on a steel bunk with a locked door he could not open. He was free. A returning soul who had done his time and found help to support him post-release. Let me ask you a question. How far did he have to go in his departure before God ran to him in the person of one disabled chaplain? Second example is a man named Tom, another returning soul whom I picked up upon his release. He had dealt with significant mental illness while incarcerated. He spent almost all of his sentence, about 8 years, in solitary confinement, a form of mental health treatment that the prison uses when they can't deal with prisoners in regular population. This has been ruled unconstitutional. The state is not allowed to put somebody with mental health needs in solitary confinement and pretend that that's mental health care, but they do it all the time. He was my first aftercare client. I met him well before I picked up Jeff. And we had been introduced in this area by a local activist in Avalon who had met Tom in SCI Pittsburgh, which is just a couple of miles from here. Tom had responded to an advertisement in a prison newsletter about if you need support after experiencing prison rape, write this name, write to this person. And this guy gave me the information, making some comment about he couldn't find clergy that would be willing to go into the prison. And I said, I don't know what I'm doing, but I'll go. One of my favorite Hebrew phrases is Hineni Adonai. Here I am, Lord. Send me. So when he got out, a few years later, since that time, I have supported him through four different periods of homelessness in tent residences, two apartments, two fiancés, five or six jobs. In fact, he started another job just this past Monday. We have talked about his future and about his growth and development and things he needs to do. But his mental health challenges make it difficult for him to think about anything more than 2 months away. Last year, his adopted grandfather died. So I'm his primary support emotionally and pastorally. Number three is a guy I'll call Dean. By the way, Tom is also a made-up name. Dean is a made-up name. And from the moment Dean climbed into my car, he could not stop crying. He had served 21 and a half years, the maximum sentence for his crimes. He had not been free this century. For a few months, every new thing led to tears. Even something as simple to us as renewing his driver's license. He hadn't had a driver's license since 1999. When he came out of the DMV with his brand new license, he couldn't stop crying. He couldn't stop telling me how much he loved me. I was the father he had never had. Remember the song? He lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes. With forgiveness in his voice, he said, son. He called me son. He said, son, do you know I still love you? He ran to me, and then I ran to him when God ran. Unfortunately, this support was not enough. Dean needed intense counseling, more than just one brother to welcome him beyond my skills. And when the troubles of life took him back to the pig pods, he died of a drug overdose, alone, in an alley. In each of these three cases, these returning souls were greeted at the moment of their release. I can barely walk, so I couldn't run to them, but their first encounter on the outside was a loving father figure, somewhat portly, who met them at the door, sometimes inside, embraced them, cried with them, and assured them of God's love and mine. When I met Jesus after that Grateful Dead concert that I showed you the album cover from, God said, tell my people I love them. He didn't tell me to go to university and teach a class. He didn't tell me to become a bishop. He just said, tell my people I love them. When Jeff was released, he had a place and several brothers to care for him. He is what I would call a success story. Tom has gotten some support, but not as much as he needs. In some weeks, he's a full-time job for me. Dean was not able to accept the help he was offered. He wasn't able to accept the idea that God ran to him. And so he turned back to his drug of choice. Like the seed that fell on shallow soil in the parable of the sower, it bloomed quickly, but was beaten down by the sun and brought down by those who supplied his habit. As I said before, there are 8 other inmates with whom I have regular contact. There are another 11 who have been told by somebody inside about this chaplain who will listen to anything you have to say and not judge you. And there are 6 returning souls on the outside who I have regular contact with. One of my models, it's a guy named Damien, and Damien was a missionary to Hawaii. Originally, his brother was called to this missionary position, but his brother got sick, and so Damien took his place. Here I am, send me. He was part of a team who split Hawaii into 4 missionary districts. Now, before you think that it would be kind of nice to be a missionary to Hawaii, another man on his team had the largest of the 4 districts, and it was simply too much for him to reach everybody. This was a horseback circuit riding program, and every day, 3 times a day, there would be a different place he would have to stop in his district. The other guy who couldn't handle that largest district traded with Damien. He took on that responsibility. And in this district, there was a leper colony numbering some 600 souls. Damien aided this colony by teaching, painting houses, organizing farms, organizing the construction of chapels, roads, hospitals, churches. He also dressed residents, dug graves, built coffins, did their funerals. But above all else, he was their pastor, and he loved them. It is said that Damien told the lepers that despite what the outside world thought of them, they were always precious in the eyes of God. Damien told God's people that he loved them. I want you to think about this picture for a little bit. Number of profound images that are kind of hidden. There's a figure over the couple that looks to me like an angel with wings spread. A couple of clouds that look like they're in the shape of a dove. On the right-hand side, there's a hand. Dream with me for a little while. Tom needs more support. Dean needed more love. Jeff has received both of these and his own place to live. And 1 out of 3 would be considered successes in their return to society. Recidivism, a difficult to pronounce word, but after a while it sort of rolls off the tongue, but is a statistic which measures how many former inmates return to incarceration. In some categories of offenses, that statistic is over 80%. 4 out of 5 people who leave prison return to prison. In other categories, it's less than 20%. In all categories, there's an element of rejection in the experience of the soul returning to society. Most neighborhoods reject anyone convicted of any crime. One of my guys coined the phrase modern lepers to describe their situation when they're released from incarceration. Nobody wants them nearby. Doesn't matter what they're charged with. Just, you know, let them live somewhere else, not in my backyard. Is it any surprise that most offenders return to prison? They are unwelcome, unloved, disrespected, distrusted, and even hated, and that's without anybody ever knowing them. They know their place when they're inside. They know how to behave in prison, but not when they're outside, not when they're on the street. I lost a paragraph. Nope. I just didn't scroll down far enough. What if there were a place where they could live with support, love, and practical assistance provided by Christian brothers and sisters who take Matthew 25 seriously? Imagine that with me for a minute. I want to focus particularly on verses 34 to 36 in Matthew 25. Then the king will say to those on his right, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you fed me." Where's May? I read that, I think of May. "I was thirsty, and you gave me a drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me into your home. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you cared for me. I was in prison, and you visited me." A little bit later, "And the king will say, I tell you the truth." The King James says that very lovely. "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, when you did it to the one of the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you were doing it to me." This is a little bit different picture of the returning soul. Damien's congregants, the members of his congregation, were in a prison called a leper colony. Molokai was the name of this place. He visited them in that prison. He lived with them in that prison. He fed them and cared for them and buried them just as if they were Christ himself. Can we do this for modern lepers? Damien went to Molokai, Hawaii in 1873. Interestingly enough, my great-grandfather began his missionary time in Turkey that same year. Got married to his wife, and for their honeymoon, they got on a ship and sailed to Turkey to begin a ministry, at the end of which he died from a disease he caught on the mission field. My father followed that same path in China, where his dad was a missionary, until the Japanese arrested him during World War II. When they released him, he returned to China until the communists took over China in 1948, and they arrested my father. They deported him. He came back to the States. He got married. My brother was born. And he returned to that same work in Korea, as close as he could get to China. He too died of an illness his congregation battled. We have this opportunity to do this right here. I don't mean here in the sanctuary, but right here in River City. These modern lepers are not contagious, so we don't need to think of them making us sick like my father or my grandfather or Damien, sorry, great-grandfather. But Jesus is there waiting for us to minister to him. Colossians 3:23, I think, says, "Whatever you do, do it as though unto the Lord, not as unto men." He's waiting for us to minister to him, to Christ himself, in the persons of Jeff, Tom, and Dean. Marie and I met Felix last year and found that we had very similar visions, even to the looking at Damien of Molokai as our model for ministering to returning souls. This is a picture that we took fairly early in that time. You look pretty sharp like that, Felix. and my beautiful wife, of course. Together we have developed a concept called Damien's Hope. Damien hoped that everybody would find a place where they would receive love and support and food and shelter, clothing, all the things that our Lord talked about in Matthew 25. They're looking for an opportunity. We're looking to create an opportunity where returning souls can get help with everything that makes post-incarceration life difficult. The biggest part of this opportunity is the biggest part of this challenge is our opportunity to respond to that charge I received next year, it'll be 50 years? Boy, I feel old. I will celebrate 50 years next summer, since that first encounter I had with Jesus. And we are planning to have a place available where these returning souls can get love, assistance, and assistance with all that makes life a challenge. We're going to create a community that celebrates the love of God 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, 366 in leap years. Now, I'm mindful that I've been talking about helping people we don't know yet. But right now, I want to talk to you about this, talk to you who are in this room. And those of you who are watching online. The song, When God Ran, is a very moving story about a prodigal who has become overwhelmed with the outrageous love of God. Blessed by his father while still a long way off, the parable of the prodigal son shows us that God the Father is watching diligently for that returning soul. Before COVID, I was part of a team. I will be again. Another one of my teammates is here. Thank you, John. And this team goes into the prison in Fayette County twice a year to teach the basics of Christianity to inmates. We call them residents. We spend 3 days inside that prison, and every week we would return and join in a prayer and share gathering with our former students. We join with them as equals. As a clergyman on this weekend, I have heard stories from residents who have never experienced the outrageous love of Jesus Christ. It's my joy to personify Christ in the delivery of this experience. They have never experienced the outrageous love of God. Have you? Worship team, please come forward. I wonder if there's somebody here in this room now, or perhaps watching online, who has never experienced the outrageous love of God. If you find yourself in need of a first touch, or like me, you need a second. Actually, it took me like 6 or 8 touches before I really got anywhere near where Jesus wanted me to be. I also wonder if there's somebody in this room or watching online who's excited about the idea of actively sharing the outrageous love of God with inmates inside or returning souls outside. I can't tell you how exciting it is and marvelous and humbling it is to represent God in this way, to personify the love of Christ when his prodigal returns. I want to share this joy with you. And if you're interested, we have a paper in the back where you can leave your name. My business card is there. Or we'd love to have you come up front and join us, because particularly we want to invite those who haven't had that touch that of the outrageous love of God. And I'd like to invite you to come forward so that we can touch you in that way.
Powerful, awesome Lord, victorious warrior, commanding King of kings, mighty conqueror, and the only time, I ever saw him run was when he ran to me. Said, my son's come home again. Lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes. With forgiveness in his voice, he said, son, do you know I still love you? He caught me by surprise when God ran. The day I left home, I knew I'd broken his heart. And I wondered then if things would ever be the same. Then one night I remembered his love for me. And down a dusty road ahead I could see it was the only time. The only time I ever saw him run, it was when he ran to me. He took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, said, my son's come home again. Lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes, with forgiveness in his voice, he said, son, do you know I still love you? He brought me to my knees when God ran. I saw him run to me. The tears from my eyes, with forgiveness in his voice, he said, son, do you know I still love you? He caught me by surprise, and he brought me to my knees when God
The place is called Damien's Hope, and I would ask that you would pray for us. May the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord smile on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord show you his favor and give you his peace, his shalom.
Thank you, Steve. Amen. Amen. It's a good word. It's a good word. I just encourage you to be, let that word come down in your heart, in your whole, in your soul, into your spirit, and change you. Be God's hands. Be his love. Be his voice reaching out to those around you that are in need. Thank you for being with us today. Thank you, Steve, for bringing the word. And if you're so inclined, the offering plates will be available on the way out. If you're online, you can take care of that on our website. Looking forward to welcoming Pastor Danny back from his vacation next week. Thank you all for being here. God bless you all, and we are dismissed.